Hey, it's Dave Brown here, host of Now with Dave Brown on AMI. Check out this latest highlight from the show. Earlier this month, William Davis, Ontario's 18th premier, passed away at the age of 92. Davis was premier from 1971 to 1985. One of the many people who knew Davis was Steve Paikin, a journalist and the host of TVO's The Agenda. Steve is also the author of the 2016 biography, Bill Davis, Nation Builder and Not So Bland After All. You can find editions in accessible formats of that book at the Center for Equitable Library Access. And Steve joins us this morning to reflect on the legacy of Bill Davis. Steve, thanks so much for making time for being with us today. We're so appreciative. So let's jump in here and talk a little bit about an expression that Bill Davis was well known for, which is bland works. Well, the title of the biography that you wrote on him says that wasn't necessarily the case. Why was that?
Well, the expression comes from a time when a reporter for the Globe and Mail, and we're going back now four decades plus, said to him, "Mr. Davis, why do you run such a boring, bland government?" And his answer was, "Bland works." And by that he meant he really didn't care if he was above the fold in the Toronto Star every single day, 60-point type headlines. In fact, he wanted quite the contrary. He wanted steady as she goes, calm, efficient, progressive, conservative government. Having said that, the fact is that a lot of the issues that he had to deal with were extremely interesting, extremely exciting, extremely important. And as a result, he leaves behind quite an impressive legacy that I dare say no other premier in my lifetime or yours can match.
So let's talk about that legacy. We've reflected with a few contributors over the course of the last week about Bill Davis's legacy in education, in human rights. What do you believe his legacy is as premier?
Well, let's break those in two. Number one, as the Minister of Education in the 1960s, he was probably our best Minister of Education, in part because that was just a great time to be Minister of Education. The economy was going gangbusters. The money was flowing in. There were programs, federal, provincial programs, which added federal money to his coffers. And as a result, he had the opportunity to build, build, build. And by that, I mean, we got the whole college system when Bill Davis was Education Minister, Ontario. We got OISE, the Ontario Institute for Studies in Education. They were so busy building schools, Dave, sometimes he had to open three schools a day. He would fly all over the province and open new schools all the time. There was additional support for the Catholic school system. There was additional support for the French school system. And I don't want to forget my favorite. What was the other thing, Dave, he created that might be at the top of my list?
I'm getting the impression some sort of a television network of some kind, of some
sort.
Well,
there you go. Yes, indeed. TVO would be pretty significant to my life, and I dare say to the lives of millions of people through the years. 50 years ago, TVO was created, and again, that was a Bill Davis production. So that was his record as education minister. Five new universities as well. I'd say that's unrivaled by any other education minister.
There's no doubt about that. And that's the kind of impact that can last a long time when you think about legacy. Steve, as you mentioned, that people really seemed to be drawn to him. What was the reason for his electoral success? 14 years as premier is no short jaunt.
No, it's the second highest total of all time, behind only Oliver Mowat, who did 24 years, and no one's ever going to break his record. Well, let's put a few things on this checklist. Number one, he really liked people. And not every politician, Dave, likes people, but he did like people. And we're hearing all sorts of stories since his death coming out about how, you know, whether he was on an airplane or whether he was at a strawberry social or at a multicultural festival, whatever it was, whatever the event, he just liked going up and meeting people and talking to people. And he liked listening to people. I think a lot of people get into politics today because they love to give speeches. Bill Davis was not the best speech giver anywhere. In fact, he was a fairly mediocre speech giver when he started his political career. He got much better as he went along, but he wasn't too good at the beginning. But what he definitely could do was listen. And he would listen to all the different competing views, be they at the cabinet table or in the caucus room or with members of the general public or special interest groups. He'd give everybody a hearing. And then he just had an ability to find the sweet spot of consensus where he thought, I can get the most buy-in if I take this position here. And I think the testament to the fact that he got it right more often than he got it wrong is that so many of the decisions that the Davis governments over those 14 years made, so many of those decisions persist today. If you're a tenant, we have rent review today because of Bill Davis. And we have basically the same system today that we had that he brought in 1975. And the list goes on and on and on. You can just make an incredibly lengthy checklist of all the things that his governments did that have stood the test of time.
Beyond being so well respected by people inside of his caucus, his cabinet, as you mentioned, other major stakeholders, he was also well liked by people across the aisle from him. His political opponents seemed to admire him. What do you think the recipe for that was?
Well, I think you said it. The word is opponent and not enemy. He did not treat the people who sat on the other side of the legislature as his political enemies who needed to be destroyed. He always, and he had this very funny expression, Dave, used to say, they may be philosophically misguided, but they got elected just as I did to come here and do the people's business, and therefore I'm prepared to work with them. And that's what he did. And remember, that was key from 1975 to 1981, when it was minority parliaments for those six straight years. You couldn't be a my way or the highway. You couldn't be a doctrinaire, ideological conservative and expect to last if that's the way you approach things. No, you had to compromise. You had to be able to reach out sometimes to the left, sometimes to the right, again, to find that sweet spot of consensus. And given his temperament and personality, he was easily able to do that.
There may be a few cynical folks in the audience today who think, was that a matter of the times? Is that even conceivable in today's politics?
Is it conceivable? Sure. Is it? Does it require a lot more effort and work today to do it? Also, yes. I mean, let's be honest. The reality of Mr. Davis's time is that there was no 24/7 all-news cable TV coverage. There was no social media. So you had you did not have that toxicity that we are experiencing today that you had to deal with. There were other issues they dealt with, other difficulties, but that wasn't a part of it. I'd like to think that the values and the approach and the collegiality that he brought to politics back in the day would work today as well, but who knows?
As I mentioned off the top of the interview, you did have a personal relationship with Bill Davis. What are some of your fondest memories of interacting and spending time with him?
Well, when I covered his last government, which was in the early 1980s, we had a very, very professional relationship. You know, he was the premier, I was a kid reporter, and I, you know, covered the issues as everybody else did. As the years went on, and I started to sort of nudge him to allow somebody, I hoped me, but mostly somebody, to write his life story, because I thought he had such a consequential political career, we became friendlier. And the negotiations that took place in order for me to get to try to convince him to cooperate on a biography just became funnier and funnier, to the point where I think he was 85 years old when my wife called him and said, "Mr. Davis, you know, my husband's not getting any younger. You may want to say yes one of these days." Well, I finally did get him to yes when he was about 86 or something like that. And just having the opportunity to spend so much time with a man, Dave, you have to remember, he became premier when I was 10. So he was and he stayed premier till I was 24. Mm. So he was his most formative years in politics were my most formative years growing up in Ontario. And the chance to spend so much time with him and see him at his cottage on Georgian Bay with his family. And they are just a magnificent group. They're so wonderful and supportive and enabled him, particularly his wife, Kathleen. Without her, there is no Bill Davis. We're not talking today without her because she enabled him to have the political career that he was destined to have. Again, something your listeners may not remember, but Mr. Davis's first wife died when she was 31, leaving him a widower at, I don't know, 32 or 33, with four kids under the age of 7. And he was extremely fortunate to remarry a woman named Kathleen Mackay, who was originally from around Chicago. And they knew each other from their time up on Georgian Bay. Her family had a cottage right near his, so they actually knew each other since they were kids. And she took his four kids into her heart, and they had a fifth. And again, without her, I mean, he doesn't become the Bill Davis that we know without her. And that's why I dedicated my book to her. Mm. She enabled it to happen. So Georgian Bay, to be sure, spent time with him at his condominium in Florida, spent time with him in Brampton, spent time with him at political events. Just some great memories, great conversations. And the funny thing is, every time I sat down with him to do an interview with him for the book, he would insist on gossiping about the politics of the day for a half an hour before I got to my first question. He stayed engaged right to the end, and just love to be part of the action.
We always say that's having your vegetables before you get to the desserts when you interact with folks in the political world. Steve, we thank you so much for your reflection today. Thank you for taking the time to be with us. I've long admired your work, and I'll be tuning in pretty much nonstop. So thank you for making time for us this morning.
You're very kind. Thanks for asking.
That is Steve Paikin, the host of TVO's The Agenda. You can also find the 2016 biography, Bill Davis, Nation Builder, and Not So Bland After All, that book available in accessible formats from the Center for Equitable Library Access. Do you want to dive into more conversations like this? Watch Now with Dave Brown weekdays at 9 a.m. Eastern on AMI TV or download the podcasts wherever you listen. Do you want to dive into more conversations like this? Watch Now with Dave Brown weekdays at 9 a.m. Eastern on AMI TV or download the podcasts wherever you listen.